Hello and welcome to our new series of Christchurch Tunbridge Wells Youth Services. A lot's happened since we were last together. We had Christmas, New Year, a new lockdown, homeschooling's back, and it's been my birthday. So a crazy few weeks. However you found this time, we hope that you have really felt God's peace with you. And if actually you are feeling a bit rubbish and times have been tough and you might be feeling scared or anxious or not know what's going on, actually we pray that by the end of today that you will really feel God's presence with you and that you will feel the comfort and peace that can be found through Him. I thought it'd be really great before we start today just to pray together to get ourselves ready to meet with God this morning. Thank you, God, that we are able to meet through these youth services together. And I pray that today, whatever's been our experience of the last few weeks, whatever's happened, that you will really meet with us and that we'll really know your presence with us today, God. That wherever we're watching this, that we know that you are with us. Amen. Amen. Now, if this is your first time watching one of our services, then we want to give you an extra special welcome. What we do at the start of our services is we set you two challenges for the week. Now, each week we want to see different things. We start with a riddle and then we have another challenge. And all these challenges go towards points on a leaderboard that win you by the end of the term, if you are the one that completes the most challenges, an edible prize of your choosing. Now, last term, Ben and Naomi were our joint winners and Sebi was very close behind in third place. So if you want to knock them off the top and take away their crowns and get the edible prize yourself, our first challenge is coming up. So over to Rebecca now.
Welcome to the first Rebecca's Riddle of 2021. And I'm very excited to share this week's riddle with you. It is, I'm as light as a feather, but yet the strongest person can't hold me for 5 minutes. What am I? Please send your guesses and your answers to Jacob.
All you need to do if you have worked out the answer to the riddle is send me your answer and your points will go on the leaderboard. If you're not 100% sure, then don't worry. Send me what you think it could be, and if you are right but you give it a good go, we'll give you points anyway. And so you can still get points even if you're not 100% sure on the answer. Our second challenge this week comes linking in with the topic for today's youth service, New Year, New Me. And as it's been Christmas and you've had time off from school and you may have received lots of new presents, we want to see something new that you've got. So it might be a present that you received, it might be something you've done with your spare time, it might be a new hobby that you've learned. Send us in a picture or a video to jacob@cctw.org.uk and show us your new thing. Now, it's only fair that I join in with this too, and so I want to show you a present I received from Rebecca's dad. This is my brand new rubber duck. You might be able to make out that it's a Boris Johnson rubber duck. Something I never knew that I needed in my life, and I still don't think I need it now, but it's good company when I'm in the bathroom. Brushing my teeth, I can look at Boris and know that all is well in the world. So yeah, that's my new thing. If you think that you can do better than my rubber duck, then send in your pictures and videos. And if you want them to feature in next week's service, then send them to me by Wednesday and we can put them in if you're happy for us to do so. So remember, new things and riddle answers, send them over to me. And we're going to go into a time of worship now. And Noah's going to lead us in that. But before we do, let's just get ourselves in that place to worship God together. So let's pray. Lord, I want to thank you for Noah and his gift in worship and for spending time to send us some worship and leading us in that, God. And so I just pray today that through that you will really meet with us, that you'll really connect with us, that we will just really experience your presence through worshiping together. Amen.
Good morning, Christchurch Youth. Let's worship together. My mind to count. see his wounds, his hands, his feet. My Savior on a cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in
to Noah for that wonderful time of worship. And this term we're talking about a new topic, and that topic is Jesus the Game Changer. So between Christmas and Easter, we're going to explore how Jesus's life can help us, others, and the world around us be transformed. And this week we're talking about the topic New Year, New Me, and how Jesus can help us become the versions of ourselves that we want to be. But first, let me do our reading from 2 Corinthians Verse 15 to 17. And he died for all, that those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for him who died for them and was raised again. So from now on, we regard no one from a worldly point of view. Though we once regarded Christ in this way, we do so no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come, the old has gone, and the new is here.
One of my favourite things about a new school year was getting a brand new exercise book. Now, you're either going to be able to understand this or you're going to think I'm really sad. But actually, getting a new exercise book was really nice for me because I have got awful handwriting. I'm left-handed, and the only pens that seemed to not smudge for me were really cheap biros. Like, they were 5p from my school library. And so I used to write with those because they didn't smudge, but it meant that the ink didn't look very nice on the page, and it just often turned into a mess really quickly. So I was really glad when I got a brand new exercise book, because it felt like a fresh start, that all the mistakes I'd made in my previous books, all the messy handwriting, all the way that I'd scribbled and it didn't look very nice, was gone, and I got a brand new exercise book. Now, I normally was able to keep it looking nice for a couple of pages, but by the time I was a week into using the book, it looked like a mess every time. And so I started to just think, you know what, getting a new exercise book wasn't a very nice thing after all, because I knew it was going to turn into a mess. But we'll come back to talking about that later. We've recently experienced a new year. It's 2021 now, and 2020 has gone. And for a lot of people, they were really excited that we've got a new year, that 2020 is over, and that we're able to get a new year. It's full of new hope and new optimism, and we can be excited that all the rubbish stuff that happened in 2020, the kind of the year where everything seemed to be going wrong and things became more and more difficult, was gone. And actually 2021 looked like it was full of hope. We've got a vaccine, which means that it looks like we're going to be able to defeat this virus soon. And so 2021 brought a lot of hope for people, which was really great. And at New Year, people often set resolutions to try and set themselves a challenge of doing something good in the new year. It might be to exercise more, it might be to eat better, it might be to stop being mean to your brothers or your sisters, or be nicer to your parents, or do more chores, or do something, break a bad habit where you get to do something good as a result. And I don't know if you've set a New Year's resolution this year, but I might give you some statistics that might not feel too great about it now. Psychology magazine did a study on 3,000 people to see how they did keeping their New Year's resolution. This was back at about 10 years ago. And they looked at these 3,000 people, and at the start of the year, 52% of people felt really determined that this year they were going to be able to do their resolution, that they'd set themselves something that they felt that they were going to do, that they had all that determination to do it. And by the end of the year, out of that 52%, actually out of the whole study, only 12% of people managed to do it, to keep their resolution. So that means that out of 3,000 people, only 360 or so actually managed to do their resolution. For the other 2,640 people, they didn't manage it. They gave up. And so they went back to the bad habit that they were feeling. And so this phrase that we can hear sometimes, new year, new me, actually for them, it wasn't like they were a new person. They went back to their old habits. And so they would have felt really disheartened and felt a bit rubbish about the fact that they might have wanted to set out to be new, but they weren't able to be new. They weren't able to be the new me that they wanted to be. In today's reading, we heard that when we're in Jesus, when we follow Jesus and are in partnership with Jesus, that we are a new creation. And we're going to look today about what that means. And the title of this talk is New Year, New Me, because we're in a new year. And I want us to look at what it means to be the new me that God has called us to be. And so we hear this phrase, new creation. The Message Bible, which is another translation, words the same passage like this. Now we look inside, and what we see is that anyone who is united with the Messiah, that's Jesus, gets a fresh start, is created new. The old life is gone and a new life begins. Look at it. All of this comes from God, who settled the relationship between us and him. So the first point I want to look at today is that relationship between us and God and Jesus, and the phrase that it says, united with the Messiah, so united with Jesus. What does it mean for us to be united with Jesus? Right back at the beginning of creation, when God makes human beings, he says in Genesis 1 verse 27 that we are made in the image of God. Now, sometimes that we think about that phrase and we think that it means that God's got eyes and nose and mouth and hair like this or like that, or ears. And actually, no, it's not about being physically made in the image of God. It doesn't mean that we all look a bit like God if you stood us all up in a line. but it means that we're made with the same purpose as God. That God has got a purpose in the world, in creating the world and sustaining the world, and we have a purpose too. And that purpose is linked with God's purpose. That it's kind of passed on, like if God ran a shop and we worked in the shop, and we've kind of got a purpose to help make that shop successful. And it'd be like us, the workers, saying that they were made in the image of the shop owner. That's what we're like. And so we have got this calling and this purpose on the earth to use our skills and our gifts and our talents, the things that God's put inside of us, to make the world a better place that glorifies God, that makes this world an amazing habitat for human beings to thrive in, and it glorifies God at the same time through that. And so that's what we're called to do. That's the partnership that we are called to have with God, but right back at the beginning of creation. And you might know that in the story of in Genesis, Adam and Eve choose to make a decision to set what's right and wrong and what's good and bad in their own eyes. They decided to follow what they thought was best. And so by eating the fruit from the tree. And so that partnership is broken. And because human beings, as part of that agreement that we have, like the shop worker working for the shop owner, the shop worker needs to do what the shop owner says and follow the decisions that the shop owner says. And so we have got to follow what God says is right and wrong, because actually God knows what's best for us. God knows, because he made us, he's our father, he knows what's the best decisions for us. And when we choose to make decisions that we think are best, so it might be that we're mean to people, it might be that we tell a lie, it might be that we're rude, it might be that we think that something is good and actually God says it's not good. And so when we choose to do something that God says is not good, that's when we make decisions to define good and evil for ourselves. And this is what Adam and Eve did right back at the start of Genesis. And so that partnership is broken, but there is hope. Jesus's death and resurrection allows us to have that partnership back. It allows us to say, look, we know that we've made a mistake, God, when we choose to define what is good and bad by doing things that we know are wrong. But actually, God, we want to follow you and want you to be the one that defines what's good and bad. And Jesus' death and resurrection means that we get forgiveness. We get that bad stuff taken away, and we can have that partnership back that God created us to have. We can be partners again with God. That's what Paul's saying in this passage, that we can live that life that God has designed for us. How amazing is that? That's brilliant news, I think. You might have heard a message like this before, talking about this bad stuff we've done and how Jesus' death and resurrection means that we are forgiven and that we can live like a new creation. And like me, I've heard a message like this lots and lots of times. And it's not a bad message. It's a really good message. But we don't really know how that feels, or I certainly didn't know how it feels. I might have been told that my sins were forgiven, but I would sometimes go and sin again and make another mistake, and I would feel really disheartened. And it's like, well, I didn't feel that different when God said I was forgiven from my sins. And so I go and do something bad again. And it's just this repetitive cycle of, actually, I'm just starting to feel disheartened. I'm starting to feel like somebody that makes a New Year's resolution, but I know I'm not going to keep it because I don't feel any different. It might be that, like when I got that exercise book and I started writing in it again, and I knew that actually it was going to go wrong again. And so I just felt a bit rubbish. It didn't feel new to me. It just felt like it was cursed, like it was about to go wrong again. But actually, I found this whole idea of a new year and that feeling we get from a new year, or that feeling we get from a new book, really helpful to understand what it's like when Jesus forgives us. That hope we get when we get a fresh start, when it's all clean, and it means that there are no blemishes, there's nothing that's damaged the kind of the look of the book or the new year yet, when we're really excited. That's how it feels when we're a new creation. That feeling when you turn over the page and it's all blank and it's ready for you to go. And because an exercise book doesn't just sit there and sit on a shelf. Its purpose is to be written in and like our purpose is to be in the world and doing stuff in the world. We're not meant to just sit there trying not to make any mistakes. We're there to try and make the world a great place for God and that glorifies God, and a great place for other people, just like an exercise book. You need to be doing stuff in it. And when we make a mistake in our exercise book, it's like Jesus goes, look, I'm going to take away that old exercise book and I'm going to replace it with a new one, and you get a fresh start. You get a clean slate. You get to go again. And there's an endless supply of exercise books. There's nothing we can do. There's no mistake we can make in an exercise book. Even if you let the ink, you put your pen on and the ink seeps down through all the pages, actually you just get a new one and there's no ink stain on it. That's what it's like when Jesus forgives us. And so if, like me, you sit there and you've listened to the first half of this talk and you're like, yeah, it's really nice, I know that, but I don't really know how that feels, then can I give you a practical suggestion of how you can know what it feels like? If you get a piece of paper, it doesn't need to be huge, you can chop an A4 sheet in half or get a small piece and just put it somewhere that you can see it. Put it somewhere on your desk or in your bedroom somewhere. Stick it so that when you pray for forgiveness, that you can look at it and go, well, that's how God sees me now. He doesn't see me as a piece of paper with loads of mistakes scribbled on, or lots of horrible words that people have said about me, or things that I think about myself that aren't true. Actually, God sees me as a blank sheet of paper, that he sees me as a fresh start, as a new creation, ready again in partnership with God to go and do his purposes in the world, to go and use the skills and gifts and the amazing talents that God's given you. You can now go and use them for God's glory in the world again. That's how God sees you. That's the new creation that we are. So when we say new year, new me, when we pray for forgiveness, we get like a brand new year. Like all the bad stuff, just think about 2020 and all the challenges that we got through and the hope we had about 2021. That's what we can feel like when we go into this forgiven state as a new creation. And Jesus and God wants that partnership with us. He doesn't send us out from the Garden of Eden metaphorically now because he wants to. He wants us to be in partnership with him, but as part of that agreement, we have to follow what he says and choose to follow what he says. So today, can I encourage you to, again, go to God and say, look, God, I want to be in partnership with you. I want to be united with you to bring about your purpose for the world. And I know that as part of that, I'm going to have to listen to what you say is good and what's not good to do. But Lord, when I make mistakes, when I make decisions that and define what's good and bad in my opinion, that you will forgive me and help me feel like that new exercise book, that new year again. And look at a piece of paper when you do. Put it up on somewhere where you can see it so you can know that that's how God sees you. And I think that's in a really powerful way that we can see how Jesus is the game changer for us. That when we make mistakes, that Jesus changes the game, that we don't have to live in those mistakes anymore, that they're gone, that we don't have to feel the oppression of those mistakes anymore. Because when Jesus forgives us, they're gone and we are brand new in him. We are a new creation. We are going to worship together now. So as we do, just say that prayer to God. Thank him for wanting to be in partnership with us, and pray that you will feel like that new creation today.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. To this grace that torn my heart to feel, and grace my me, and like a flood.
shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine, but God who called me here below will be forever mine, will be forever mine. My chains are gone, my chains are gone.
I hope that today that you can really understand what it feels like to be a new creation, that you'll remember that image of the blank sheet of paper, or that feeling you get at a new year or a new exercise book, and you can really know what God wants you to feel when he says that you're a new creation. I also hope that you feel excited about being united again with God to bring about his purpose to the world, and how we can play our part in that through Jesus. So remember this week that Jesus is a game changer for us, and that he can transform us, and so we can fulfill our purpose through God. How amazing is that? I hope that you have a great week, and that whatever happens, that you know that God is with you and you feel his peace and his presence with you every step of the day. And I just, we can't wait to see you next week. We're looking forward to seeing your challenges, and so send those in, don't forget that. And have a great week. See you soon.